Hello and welcome to the first of the Zap Chat videos, and this one is about the authentication tester. So what is the tester and why would you want to use it? Well, if you're just doing manual testing with Zap, then you probably don't need to bother. You don't need to worry about it because you can authenticate your target application and you don't have to worry about getting Zap to handle authentication for you. So your life is easier. However, if you want to automate Zap, then you probably do need to get Zap to authenticate your application, and that can be tricky. And that is why you might want to use the authentication tester. And even though it's a manual tool, it's something that will help with authentication. So for those of you who don't know, Zap has very powerful authentication support, but it's a little bit complicated. You have to understand exactly how authentication works for your application and configure Zap correctly. This can be tricky, and that is why we've added an option for Zap to automatically detect the authentication, session handling, and verification that your application needs. So with that, I will now share my screen and we'll get stuck in. So first of all, I'm going to show you zaproxy.org, and the reason for doing this is so that I can show you the documentation. So if you go to the documentation, scroll down and you'll see authenticate. And the reason for showing you this is because it all depends on when you're watching this video. If you're watching this video within a few weeks of me recording it, everything should be as it is now. However, we're gonna keep on improving things. So if you're watching in a couple of years' time, some of the restrictions I mentioned may well no longer be restrictions. So do check the documentation. So now I will switch to Zap. And the first thing I'm going to do is show you context. Now, contexts are important when it comes to authentication because this is where we configure it. We do have, Zap has lots of different ways of configuring it, including sort of global configuration via these options here. But as soon as you get to application specific configuration, that's where you need a context because this is how Zap will associate information with parts of your application. So we just have a look at the default context, which you always get. Then we scroll down, we see authentication. And there are a whole set of different options here. And you will see the auto detect option down here. And whichever one of these you choose, there will be different options based on what Zap needs to know. You'll also see a verification strategy. Now, this is how Zap tells whether you're still logged in. So for a traditional web application, you can check every request or response, but for a more modern web application, you're probably going to need a poll, a specific URL. Zap will also need to know a regex pattern used for identifying whether you're logged in or logged out, or ideally both. Then we have the users. You have to specify at least one user with their credentials, and session management. And again, there's loads of different options and you'll have to configure different things depending on which of these options you choose. And Zap does support script-based session management and script-based authentication. So you can configure Zap to handle whatever you like. If you can handle authentication, then Zap will be able to handle it. Obviously, if you're using something like two-factor authentication, then you need to be able to get the 2FA token to Zap. But otherwise, Zap should be able to handle it if you understand how to configure it. Now, you may be wondering why you don't put Zap into auto-detect mode all of the time, because that would make your life easier. And the reason is we know it won't work in all cases. So, you know, you can either set up your automation with auto-detect and then try and debug it when it goes wrong. If it goes wrong, that can be tricky. Or we've got this authentication tester dialog, which makes it very easy to work out whether Zap can handle it. So I'll cancel that, and then you may not be able to see this, but there's a tools menu at the top, and then there's the authentication tester. Now, before I actually run this, I need an application to test. So I'll cancel that and go to the quick start, and I'm going to use an application called OWASP Juice Shop. So OWASP Juice Shop is a delivery vulnerable application, and it's a modern web app, so it's a really good one for us to test with. Now, what we'll need to do is we will need to set up a user, we'll need to register. So you go to login, get rid of these annoying dialogues, And I'll use my standard test accounts, test at test.com and test123. Actually, no, I need to go to not a customer. This is where I register. We also have to answer a security question with the answer test, of course. So register there, and hopefully now we should be able to log in. So test at test.com and test123. And you'll see we've logged in because we've now got a basket. So that is all great. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to close this browser and I'm going to reopen it. I'm going to launch a browser again. Just to point out that when I launch a browser again, I am not logged in anymore. And now at the moment, ZAP is not trying to handle authentication, but even if ZAP was handling authentication by injecting session tokens, then it wouldn't cope with this because with many, if not all modern web applications, they maintain some authentication state within, or session state within the browser. And this is a real pain because if you've got a modern web application, then you need to expand, you're doing automation, you probably need to explore it using the Ajax Spider. That will launch browsers. These will not be logged in. That is important for a reason I'll explain later. So now I've done that and shown when I launch a browser, it's not logged in. I'm going to go to the Tools menu and I've got ZAP selected, go to Tools, and we'll use the Authentication Tester. So I've got the login page already in there and the username and password, which is just test123. Now, there's a wait time here. I mean, all you need to provide is login URL and the credentials. We have a wait time because some modern web apps take a while to initialize, and we want them to initialize successfully and to make a whole load of requests from which we can detect the session management. So we have a 5-second wait. If your application takes longer to initialize, you may well want to increase that. I'm also using demo mode, and this just adds in extra sleeps so it's more obvious what's going on. I can talk over it. So I will run the test, and that will launch Firefox again, go straight to the login page. I'll dismiss this manually. Doesn't matter if I do or not. You can see ZAP is filling in those fields, and there we are, and we can see we've logged in successfully, and ZAP closes the dialog, and we can see everything is configured. So we detect the username, password, session handling, and verification URL, and everything's passed. So what I'll do now is have a look at ZAP, and you'll see we have this new authentication test context, which we can change the name in that dialog. And if we open this, and have a look at the authentication, you will see that it's set up browser-based authentication. This is not a surprise because it's the only one that's supported. We don't use auto-detect because that would just detect things like form-based authentication or JSON-based. Because it's a modern web application, we want to use browser-based authentication because then we can configure the Ajax Spider to use this when it launches browsers. And we scroll down, we'll see it has detected the Who Am I page, and it has got a regex pattern to identify that we're logged in. So it has successfully detected everything we wanted to there, and set users, it will have added the user that we supplied, and with session management, it is correctly identified header-based session management. It's got the authorization header in twice, minor bug there, doesn't make any difference, it still works fine. But you'll notice we're supplying the bearer, and then we've got this token here. And if you look at the help underneath, you'll see that this is JSON authentication response data. So when we authenticate, the response is JSON, and there's an authentication.token field, and that's the one we want to use for authorization. So this means ZAP has successfully detected all of these things. And what you can now do is if you want to, you can either use these details as ZAP is configured, or you can put it into auto-detect mode. Obviously, the authentication you want to keep, as browser-based, but you can automatically detect the verification or session management and everything will work fine. So everything's good. So what if something goes wrong? Well, let's just go back to the dialogue so we can, I can just talk through it. First thing is, well, maybe you can't find a login URL. Not that you can't find it, but you don't have a fixed one. We've recently had someone come onto the ZAP user group and say that their application didn't have a fixed login URL. It changed every time. But when the user went to the application, they'd got redirected automatically. That's fine. Just put in the application URL into this field and then, or into the configuration for the browser-based authentication. That will launch a browser. It'll get redirected. So that'll work fine. However, if you've got to click on a link or a button, which then takes you to essentially a random URL, that would be a problem. We do have plans to fix that, but we want to know more real-world examples to make sure we fix it for everyone. So if that's the case for your application, then please get in touch and we'll ask for more details. The next thing that can go wrong is the username and password fields. One of both of those, we may fail to identify them. If that's the case, again, get in touch. We know ZAP won't handle everything. We're aiming to handle the most common cases, but we want to know the failing cases. Get in touch. We'll want to know things like the HTML for those two fields and potentially other fields if we're misidentifying one as and using the incorrect field for username or password. So we want to know more details about that. Then another option is that something else that can go wrong is session handling. Perhaps that can't identify the session. Now, we have this diagnostics tab, and this actually has loads of information. It's a lot of information about the requests and responses. But what you'll see is we are not recording things like the host name and port. So every time we see a new host and port, we're replacing it with example 0, example 1. We don't record all of the data. We just record some essential headers and structured data. Now, we keep all of the keys, but all of the tokens we replace with token 0, token 1. And if I scroll down here, you'll see, hopefully, here we've got token 439, and we're reusing it. So we can tell when tokens are values are being reused, even though we don't know the actual values. So this is partly anonymized data, and this should give us enough information to diagnose what's going wrong with your application. Do note that, obviously, here we've got OWASP JuShop, so we can tell we're using JuShop. Double check that you don't have any sensitive information and data in here before sharing this publicly. You can just replace this with something safe, and then you can share that with us via a new issue or via the ZAP user group. And that will hopefully give us enough information to understand why ZAP hasn't identified the session. Now, one reason could be that it's a more traditional app and you have not made enough requests to actually identify the session. And the same thing can happen with the verification as well. So if ZAP doesn't understand the kind of verification URL, it could just be that your application hasn't made enough requests to identify one. If that's the case, you can actually launch the browser again using this dialog. And once you're logged in, click on a few things. That might help. Otherwise, you may have to identify the verification URL yourself. That's not too difficult. We've got a lot of documentation about this. So have a look online, but also let us know what you needed to do so we can see if we can get ZAP to handle it for you. So that's it, really. That is everything that I wanted to share. And so that is the authentication tester dialogue. Please try it out and let us know how you get on, whether it's successful or whether it fails for you, and if it fails for you, what the problems were. Hope you found this video very interesting and useful. So please leave comments below and also get in touch. Leave comments about other things you'd like us to cover in this series. Thank you very much.